Hachette Audio presents The Art of Invisibility. The world's most famous hacker teaches you how to be safe in the age of Big Brother and Big Data. Written by Kevin Mitnick with Robert Vamosi. Read by Ray Porter. Foreword by Mikko, Hypponen. A couple of months ago, I met up with an old friend who I hadn't seen since high school. We went for a cup of coffee to catch up on what each of us had been doing for the past decades. He told me about his work of distributing and supporting various types of modern medical devices, and I explained how I've spent the last 25 years working with internet security and privacy. My friend let out a chuckle when I mentioned online privacy. "That sounds all fine and dandy," he said. "But I'm not really worried. After all, I'm not a criminal, and I'm not doing anything bad. I don't care if somebody looks at what I'm doing online." Listening to my old friend and his explanation on why privacy does not matter to him, I was saddened. I was saddened because I've heard these arguments before, many times. I hear them from people who think they have nothing to hide. I hear them from people who think only criminals need to protect themselves. I hear them from people who think only terrorists use encryption. I hear them from people who think we don't need to protect our rights. But we do need to protect our rights. And privacy does not just affect our rights. It is a human right. In fact, privacy is recognized as a fundamental human right in the 1948 United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. If our privacy needed protection in 1948, it surely needs it much more today. After all, we are the first generation in human history that can be monitored at such a precise level. We can be monitored digitally throughout our lives. Almost all of our communications can be seen one way or another. We even carry small tracking devices on us all the time. We just don't call them tracking devices. We call them smartphones. Online monitoring can see what books we buy and what news articles we read, even which parts of the articles are most interesting to us. It can see where we travel and who we travel with, and online monitoring knows if you are sick or sad or horny. Much of the monitoring that is done today compiles this data to make money. Companies that offer free services somehow convert those free services into billions of dollars of revenue, nicely illustrating just how valuable it is to profile internet users in mass scale. However, there's also more targeted monitoring, the kind of monitoring done by government agencies, domestic or foreign. Digital communication has made it possible for governments to do bulk surveillance, but it has also enabled us to protect ourselves better. We can protect ourselves with tools like encryption, by storing our data in safe ways, and by following basic principles of operations security, OPSEC. We just need a guide on how to do it right. Well, the guide you need is right here in your hands. I'm really happy Kevin took the time to write down his knowledge on the art of invisibility. After all, he knows a thing or two about staying invisible. This is a great resource. Read it and use the knowledge to your advantage. Protect yourself and protect your rights. Back at the cafeteria, after I had finished coffee with my old friend, we parted ways. I wished him well, but I still sometimes think about his words. I don't care if somebody looks at what I'm doing online. You might not have anything to hide, my friend, but you have everything to protect. Mikko Hypponen is the chief research officer of F-Secure. He's the only living person who has spoken at both DEF CON and TED conferences. Introduction. Time to disappear. Almost 2 years to the day after Edward Joseph Snowden, a contractor for Booz Allen Hamilton, first disclosed his cache of secret material taken from the National Security Agency, NSA, HBO comedian John Oliver went to Times Square in New York City to survey people at random for a segment of his show on privacy and surveillance. His questions were clear. Who is Edward Snowden? What did he do? In the interview clips Oliver aired, no one seemed to know. Even when people said they recalled the name, they couldn't say exactly what Snowden had done or why. After becoming a contractor for the NSA, Edward Snowden copied thousands of top-secret and classified documents that he subsequently gave to reporters so they could make them public around the world. Oliver could have ended his show's segment about surveillance on a depressing note. After years of media coverage, no one in America really seemed to care about domestic spying by the government, but the comedian chose another tack. He flew to Russia, where Snowden now lives in exile, for a one-on-one interview. The first question Oliver put to Snowden in Moscow was, "What did you hope to accomplish?" Snowden answered that he wanted to show the world what the NSA was doing, collecting data on almost everyone. When Oliver showed him the interviews from Times Square in which one person after another professed not to know who Snowden was, his response was, "Well, you can't have everyone well informed." Why aren't we more informed when it comes to the privacy issues that Snowden and others have raised? Why don't we seem to care that a government agency is wiretapping our phone calls, our emails, and even our text messages? Probably because the NSA, by and large, doesn't directly affect the lives of most of us, at least not in a tangible way, as an intrusion that we can feel. But as Oliver also discovered in Times Square that day, Americans do care about privacy when it hits home. In addition to asking questions about Snowden, he asked general questions about privacy. For example, when he asked how they felt about a secret but made-up government program that records images of naked people whenever the images are sent over the internet, the response among New Yorkers was also universal, except this time everyone opposed it. Emphatically. One person even admitted to having recently sent such a photo. Everyone interviewed in the Times Square segment agreed that people in the United States should be able to share anything, even a photo of a penis, privately over the internet, which was Snowden's basic point. It turns out that the fake government program that records naked pictures is less far-fetched than you might imagine. As Snowden explained to Oliver in their interview, because companies like Google have servers physically located all over the world, even a simple message, perhaps including nudity between a husband and wife within the same U.S. city, might first bounce off a foreign server. Since that data leaves the United States, even for a nanosecond, the NSA could, thanks to the Patriot Act, collect and archive that text or email, including the indecent photo, because it technically entered the United States from a foreign source at the moment when it was captured. Snowden's point: average Americans are being caught up in a post-9/11 dragnet that was initially designed to stop foreign terrorists, but that now spies on practically everyone. You would think, given the constant news about data breaches and surveillance campaigns by the government, that we'd be much more outraged. You would think that given how fast this happened, in just a handful of years, we'd be reeling from the shock and marching in the streets. Actually, the opposite is true. Many of us, even many readers of this book, now accept to at least some degree the fact that everything we do, all our phone calls, our texts, our emails, our social media, can be seen by others. And that's disappointing. Perhaps you have broken no laws. You live what you think is an average and quiet life, and you feel you are unnoticed among the crowds of others online today. Trust me, even you are not invisible. At least not yet. I enjoy magic, and some might argue that sleight of hand is necessary for computer hacking. One popular magic trick is to make an object invisible. The secret, however, is that the object does not physically disappear or actually become invisible. The object always remains in the background, behind a curtain, up a sleeve, in a pocket, whether we can see it or not. The same is true of the many personal details about each and every one of us that are currently being collected and stored, often without our noticing. Most of us simply don't know how easy it is for others to view these details about us or even where to look. And because we don't see this information, we might believe that we are invisible to our exes, our parents, our schools, our bosses, and even our governments. The problem is that if you know where to look, all that information is available to just about anyone. Whenever I speak before large crowds, no matter the size of the room, I usually have one person who challenges me on this fact. After one such event, I was challenged by a very skeptical reporter. I remember we were seated at a private table in a hotel bar in a large U.S. city when the reporter said she'd never been a victim of a data breach. Given her youth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.